thought tonight, we'll take a look at what Krishnamurti has to say, because we haven't worked with him for a while. And this book is on God. And unfortunately, it's coming apart. I have to retake. Okay, this is Krishnamurti. The things that thought has put together as sacred are not sacred. They are just words to give a significance to life. Because life as you live is not sacred, is not holy. The word holy comes from being whole, which means healthy, sane. All that is implied in that word. So a mind that is functioning through thought, however desirous it be to find that which is sacred, is still acting within the field of time, within the field of fragmentation. Right? Thought operates through time. Past, future. And as such, it's a fragment. It doesn't see whole. Can that mind be whole? Not fragmented. This is all part of understanding of what meditation is. Can the mind that is the product of evolution, product of time, product of so much influence, so many hurts, so many travails, such great sorrow, great anxiety, caught in all that is the result of thought. Thought that is fragmentary by its very nature. Can the mind that is the result of thought as it is now be free of the movement of thought? Can the mind be completely non-fragmented? So he's asking this question, and he really would like you to ask yourself that question. Can you look at life as a whole? Can the mind be whole, which means without a single fragment? Therefore, diligence comes into this. A mind is whole when it is diligent, which means having care, having great affection, great love, which is totally different from the love of a man and a woman. So the mind that is whole is attentive and therefore cares and has this quality of a deep, abiding sense of love. Such a mind is the whole that you come upon when you begin to inquire into what meditation is. And then we can proceed to find out what is sacred. He goes on, please listen. It is your life. Give your heart and mind to find out a way of living differently, which means when the mind has abandoned all control. This does not mean to lead a life of doing what you like, yielding to every desire, to every lustful glance or reaction, to every pleasure, to every demand of the pursuit of pleasure, but to find out whether you can live a daily life without a single control. That's part of meditation. That means one has to have this quality of attention. That means that that attention has brought about insight into the right place of thought and seen that thought is fragmentary and that where there is control, there is a controller, the controlled, which is fragmentary. So to find out a way of living without a single control requires tremendous attention and great discipline.
What do they mean by control? Is it trying to change something?
You know, we control. We try to control our thoughts. Mm. Or we try to control another person. There's a lot of, we do a lot of controlling with these thoughts, with this mind. Is it possible? And you know, we do that for security, right? We think in control, when we control, then there'll be security. So he's saying, is it possible to be free of this need to control? And to allow life to unfold as it needs to unfold. But, he's saying, this requires a lot of attention into the workings of the mind. That means to give attention to this me, right? To give a lot of attention to how this me operates, this ego presents itself. To give attention to every thought, to every feeling, to every reaction. But it cannot be with any condemnation. If we're going to do this, you can't then condemn what you see inside your own self, and certainly not inside anybody else, but to observe the workings of this mind. So this requires a tremendous attention and great discipline. We are not talking of the discipline that you are accustomed to, which is merely suppression, control, and conformity, but of a discipline that means to learn. The word discipline comes from the word disciple. The disciple is there to learn. Now here, there is no teacher and no disciple. You are the teacher and you are the disciple. If you are learning, the very act of learning brings about its own order. Now thought, now when there is order, thought has found its own place, its right place. Now, what does it mean, thought has found its right place? What does that mean? Psychologically, thought needs to find its right place, because that's what causes the suffering. That's the essence of the me, is the psychological thinking. Now the right place of thought is in functioning, You need thought to drive a car, to learn a skill, to gain knowledge in something. You need thought to write a check, to remember this address. You do need thought. But thought does not have a right place when it's the me. When it's living in the past, when it's projecting into the future. Because that's also thought. And are we able to see the difference? Do we see the difference? Do we give enough attention to this to see the difference?
I guess a good example might be certainly, thought is necessary and involved in gossiping, right? So so then the question becomes, well, is that a good use of thought to gossip? So you might decide, no, that's not a good use of thought. So I think what he gets at is, you know, thought is an instrument that we have, and where is it useful to have it applied, and where is it not useful and actually hurtful to my being when I don't see it's operating in a certain sphere. So when I'm using thought to beat myself up, let's say, about a past action, that's not a good use of thought. Or I guess it's not such a good use of thought when I'm slapping myself on the back all the time and congratulating myself. It's a useful exercise to just see where is the right use and place for thought to operate.
That's the point. The right place. The right place.
And I'm sure some people try to use thought, try to keep their minds so occupied with tasks that they never have to deal with themselves, or as little as possible, you know.
Absolutely, yeah.
And that's, at first I thought, well, you know, bad thought is thought that's self-involved and egotistical. But then I thought, but there are plenty of people who keep themselves away from self-examination anyway, or self-reference. They're focused outwardly. And
yes, escaping.
Mm.
Escaping from, that's right. And then there's no attention to the movement of thought.
Right.
The more you escape, the less you're giving attention to the movement of thought. Now, work is not just escape activity. Work is work. But we usually fill up our calendars with activity, which tends to be escape. Escape from this me, with its fears and anxieties. Let's see what else he says.
Well, you know, we're all probably more astute with where we put our energies. Like, you know, we probably know it's not such a good idea to put a lot of energy into, a friendship that has disappointed me, or that it's not useful to put a lot of resources into a house that's got a really bad foundation. We may learn that it's not good to put a lot of economic resources into shaky stocks, but we don't use that same kind of judgmental, that same kind of discretion when we think of just where do we use and put our thoughts, our thinking power.
Mm.
We just let our thoughts kind of run free, rather than see it as this, like, you know, specialized aspect of being human that has all this potential, but has to carefully be kind of directed.
What do you mean directed?
Carefully directed into where I put it and what I use it for.
See, but I'm wondering if you can do that. We don't know what our next thought is going to be. It just pops, it just comes, it just appears, right? So what best we can do is give attention, put awareness to the thought that appears.
Yes, that's exactly right.
And it's almost like thought itself then can see it's not in its right place. If one is dwelling on what this person said to me or did to me, right? If there's a constant obsessive dwelling about it, then if you shine the spotlight of awareness on it, if there is attention to it, you can put a pin in that. And it stops. It may continue again, so again, you pull the plug on it. That's what Krishnamurti says is true meditation. Wait, let me just, I'll let him tell us. Just one moment. Meditation demands constant watchfulness, constant awareness of every word, every thought and feeling, which reveals the state of our own being, the hidden as well as the superficial. And as that is arduous, we escape into every kind of comforting, deceptive thing, and we call it meditation. But to be aware of responses, to be aware of the movement of thought and feeling, without any sense of condemnation, so that the movement of the self, the me, the ways of the self, the me, are completely understood. That way is the way of right meditation. So one must give attention to that.
So is he referring to the sit with crossed legs and keep your back straight kind of meditation, or from the moment you wake up, an awareness?
Absolutely. It's an ongoing, that watchfulness.
So there's a difference between that watch, like diligence.
That's
and
right.
Control.
That's right. There's no control with that.
That's just doing.
There's no control, because if there's control, then there's a controller.
You're not trying to change it, you just noticing.
That's right. You're not trying to do anything with it, because then that's the me again, controlling and doing. But the observing is coming from awareness. And in the seeing is the doing. Because in the seeing is the interrupting. But it cannot be, and this is so important, it can't be with any kind of blame or judgment or any kind of dialogue around it. Because then you're back into the me again. It's just pure seeing. Pure seeing.
I choose to call that the light of awareness, because if I stick to the light of awareness and remember to get back there whenever I deviate from it, and it seems to work for me.
That's right. Because that light of awareness is what you fundamentally are.
It's funny because it brings that up. For the last couple of days, I've been trying to write a song somewhere. I've just started drumming it. So it goes like, baby, I am the, I was born, I was born to shine. It still stays with the light of awareness. And then the second line goes, the day you met me, you hit a gold mine. It's egotistical because I'm questioning, I'm saying, I'm talking about me, you're supposed to talk about somebody else when you... But it kind of reminds me of what you're saying.
So, can the mind, your mind, be absolutely quiet, without control, without the movement of thought? It will be quiet naturally if you really have the insight that brings about the right place for thought. Thought has its right place, and therefore the mind is quiet. You understand what the words silence and quiet mean. There is silence between two noises. There is silence between two notes. There is silence between two movements of thought. There is silence of an evening when the birds have made their noise chattering and have gone to bed. When there isn't a flutter among the leaves, there is no breeze, there is absolute quietness. Not in a city, but when you're out with nature, when you're with the trees or sitting on the banks of a river, there silence descends on the earth. And you are part of that silence. So there are different kinds of silence. But the silence we are talking about, the quietness of a mind, that silence is not to be bought, is not to be practiced, is not something you gain as a reward, a compensation to an ugly life. It is only when the ugly life has been transformed into the good life. By good, I mean not having plenty, but the life of goodness. In the flowering of that goodness, that beauty, then silence comes. So it's so interesting he's differentiating here between the silence that comes from that which is sacred, and silence as we understand it, which is important. But then he goes on to say, it can happen best when the, he calls it the ugly life, is transformed into the good life. And what does he mean by good life? What
an
is
ugly
mean?
Life. Huh? Yeah. What does he mean by both?
All right.
Terms?
Well, what do you think it
right.
means? What is a good life? Not the good life of, you know,
yeah,
like he
life.
Said, of having, oh, the good life.
A peaceful life.
A peaceful life. A peaceful life. A life where you don't hurt anyone, and you don't hurt yourself. A life that's simple and well-ordered.
And kind, that's the word I think,
kind.
The way you were describing it, kind.
Kind. Where goodness flowers. A life in which goodness flowers. And if you have that in yourself, you're going to radiate that outside yourself. He goes on, You also have to inquire into what beauty is. What is beauty? Yeah.
Wouldn't you also have to say the ugly life, so to speak, is, you know, the automatic life of inattention and reaction?
Yes.
Yeah,
and
that would be
In
harmful ways.
Yes. Inattention.
Right. It's like that, you know, the famous quote, the unexamined life is not worth living. So when we when we're just on automatic and our insecure ego is running the show, then I think that creates the life of ugliness or a life of suffering.
Yes.
And clearly he's talking about the silence of a quiet mind. So if your mind is quiet, then you can touch the sacredness that he's pointing to. But in order to get a quiet mind, it can't be running on automatic.
Right. What is beauty? Have you ever gone into this question? Will you find it in a book and tell me, or tell each other that book says what beauty is? What is beauty? Did you look at the, now he's speaking to these people that are at his talk. Did you look at the sunset this evening as you were sitting there? The sunset was behind the speaker. Did you look at it? Did you feel the light and the glory of that light on a leaf? Or do you think beauty is sensuous, and that a mind that is seeking sacred things cannot be attracted to beauty, cannot have anything to do with beauty, and therefore only concentrate on your little image that you have projected from your own thought as the good? If you want to find out what meditation is, you have to find out what beauty is. Beauty in the face, the beauty of action, the beauty of behavior, conduct, the inward beauty, the beauty of the way you walk, the beauty of the way you talk, the beauty of the way you gesture. All that is beauty. And without having that, meditation becomes merely an escape, a compensation, a meaningless action. So this is so beauty in the way you speak, beauty in the way you walk, you talk. So that would have to then reflect that flowering of goodness. So there couldn't be that violent communication, as you were saying before. Right? So there would be a gentleness, a sensitivity. There would be a caring. All that is beauty. And there is beauty in frugality. Frugality in words, in thoughts, you know. There is beauty in great austerity, not the austerity of the sannyasi, the austerity of a mind that has order. Order comes when you understand the whole disorder in which you live. And out of that disorder comes naturally order. That is virtue. Order comes when you understand the whole disorder in which you live. And out of that disorder comes naturally. Order comes naturally. Order, that is virtue. Therefore, virtue, order, is supreme austerity. Not the denial of three meals a day, or fasting, or shaving your head, and all the rest of that business. So there is order, which is beauty. Order, which is beauty. There is beauty of love. Beauty of compassion. And also, there is the beauty of a clean street, of good architectural form of a building. There is beauty of a tree, a lovely leaf, the great big branches. To see all that is beauty, not merely to go to museums and talk everlastingly about beauty. The silence of a quiet mind is the essence of that beauty. Because it is silent, and because it is not the plaything of thought, then in that silence there comes that which is indestructible, which is sacred. In the coming of that which is sacred, then life becomes sacred. Your life becomes sacred. Our relationship becomes sacred. Everything becomes sacred because you have touched that thing that is sacred. So here it seems he's describing awareness of beauty in every facet of your life. A building, a tree, a face, a dog, a baby, a house. An awareness of beauty all in every facet. That's why it's so interesting. Not just going to museums. I mean, go to museums, of course, but see the beauty outside and then look at the beauty inside your own self. He speaks about this because it's really important and because he's pointing you, pointing all of us, to awareness and the awareness of beauty, because that beauty is part of that which is sacred. That's all part of the absolute. That's all part of the background that you are.
Well, it was like this. It was creating this synergistic. It was all synergistically woven together, the goodness, the beauty, the silence, the order.
Right.
Right? It just synergistically all comes together. It's almost like impossible to separate them.
So why is it that 90% of the population thinks that's boring?
Right. So, but then the question is, what is it that thinks it's boring? The me thinks it's boring. The me that's thought thinks it's boring. Because here you're being asked to watch the movement of thought. That does not seem boring at all. That's an arduous task, right? That requires a lot of energy. I think we may be too lazy for that.
You know, I can relate to that question because I feel my mission is to capture and share the beauty of the Hamptons and the Eastern Long Island. And I find that I put so much effort into it. I love doing it, I'll do it no matter if I get feedback or not. But most people I find it boring. It's like, big deal here. It's everywhere. I don't have to go there. But it's not going to keep me from doing what I'm doing because I love what I'm doing. But most people don't appreciate real beauty because they're too caught up in everyday living, the rat race, whatever you want to call it.
I'm curious what makes a person make that first shift to go from indoctrinated beliefs to the seeking of what Krishnamurti is presenting here.
Well, what did it in you?
Extreme despair,
mm-hmm.
and negative self brought on, which I did not take responsibility for,
mm-hmm.
and the great opportunity, like most things I do, I have no clue what I'm stepping into, going to Avatar and studying with Harry Palmer. And once I got a taste of it, there was no stopping me.
Right. So you're saying it started with a despair, a deep despair, an unhappiness, a suffering.
Yes.
And you wanted to end that.
I didn't yet, well, I suppose I did, but I didn't know what I was entering. When I had no clue of the, it's all about this and the undefinable awareness and learning that I had no knowledge of my own thoughts.
Right.
And I certainly took no responsibility for what I was thinking.
But did you know it was your mind that was creating that suffering?
Not before I went there, but I went there mm-hmm. not to find out these wonderful secrets of how we can live better. I went there because I was so lonely and had not had a vacation and didn't want to travel by myself. And this was an international group that came from all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I knew about it.
Yes, yes, yes. But the impetus was the loneliness, the despair, the unhappiness. So I think that's what has most people beginning to look at, there must be something more than this. How do I get out of this?
So it wasn't a frightening experience. I think I never laughed so hard in my life or cried so hard. But the immediate effect of it was really, really changed my life.
Yes, of course.
And the thought of meeting one's ego, you know, I was not going to give that up. I'm me, I'm going to be me, and I'm going to be the best at this and the best at that. The thought of giving that up, I'm not interested in anything you have to tell me. I'm keeping that ego tight in rein. And it was such a gentle process, kind of humiliating, but so ridiculously funny once that awareness was made to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I learned that when I thought I was showing up, I wasn't even present to any situation. It was always all about me.
Right.
So when my mother had a stroke and my aunt, both of them had Alzheimer's,
mm-hmm.
and the medical issues were really building up. And every time I went to do my sibling time to be with them, I would stop in the airport and get a bottle of vodka.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't drink.
Yeah.
But this, I was preparing myself, and my body was already like, why do I have to go through this? Why is this so painful for me to watch these people that were vital to me in this condition? It was all about me.
Mm-hmm.
And after Avatar, which is really effective, they do 1 week on appreciation.
Mm.
studying, looking at, learning about, checking in with it. And that to learn to appreciate anybody else's creations of thought. It's no longer a judgment.
Mm-hmm.
It's just kind of an openness, and to be open to appreciate, allow them that space.
Mm-hmm.
And that time when I went to see my mother, who was frantic because I was 5 minutes late, and that's how the Alzheimer mind overdramatizes everything. And she opened the door, and I was in this great, great light of appreciation. And she stood there, and instead of the immediate reaction and responses we always had, I didn't see her as her disease. I didn't see anything happening to me. I just totally appreciated, and she stopped dead in her tracks and said, what did they do to you there? I don't know, but it's wonderful.
That's great.
Wow.
And I think of all the years I missed that connection with her.
Yes.
Because I was so locked in my own ego.
Yes.
And then I said, I want to know everything there. I'm going there. That's how I do it.
Yes.
Thank you for listening.
Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing.
Yes.
But just, it's amazing that other people really feel it. Like, it's a gift, such a gift.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
To each other, it's like their full attention that's not turned around into ego.
That's right.
It's all going out.
So, we have also to find out in meditation if there is something or there is nothing that is eternal and timeless, which means, can the mind that has been cultivated in the area of time, can that mind find out, come upon, or see that thing that is from everlasting to everlasting? It means, can the mind be without time? Psychological time. Though time is necessary to go from here to there and all the rest of it, can that mind, that very same mind that operates in time, going from here to there, not psychologically, but physically, can that mind be without time? Without time psychologically. Which means, can that mind be without the past? Without the present? Without the future? Can that mind be in absolute nothingness? Don't be frightened of that word. Because it's empty, it's got vast space. Have you ever observed in your own mind if you have any space at all there? Just space, you know, space. Or is everything crowded? Crowded by your worries, by your sex or no sex, by your achievements, by your knowledge, by your ambitions, by your fears, by your anxieties, by your pettiness, crowded. How can such a mind understand or be in that state of being or have that enormous space? Space is always enormous. A mind that has no space in daily life cannot possibly come upon that which is eternal, which is timeless. That is why meditation becomes extraordinarily important. Not the meditation that you all practice. That is not meditation at all. The meditation of which we are talking transforms the mind. It is only such a mind that is the religious mind. And it is only such a religious mind that can bring about a different culture, a different way of life, a different relationship, a sense of sacredness, and therefore great beauty and honesty.
Sounds like you're describing transcendental meditation in a way, because it's transcending our way.
When he speaks of meditation, he's talking about what I read to you just before, that constant awareness of the movement of your own thoughts. Not to control it, just to see and to be able to let go moment by moment, so that there's space, so there's openness, so there's emptiness. That doesn't mean that thought won't come in its right place, but not all that psychological garbage.
If suddenly thought functioned in its right place, then immediately there would be created a lot of extra bandwidth in your consciousness. That's the way you could declutter your consciousness by watching the movement of thought.
And that's what he means by order,
right.
The decluttering.
Right. And if your thinking ran along right lines, if thought was used as an instrument in a proper fashion, you would also be automatically disengaging and disempowering your ego, because the ego is thought.
Right.
The ego moves and lives through thinking. When I'm sitting really quietly in that silence that he talked about, there's no ego there. There's no ego in the silence of a quiet mind. The ego thrives in the chattering mind.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like the ego is full of hot air.
I just want to read to you a little bit of Krishnamurti when he talks about that being touched by the sacred. He writes, "The room became full with that benediction. Now what followed is almost impossible to put down in words. Words are such dead things, with definite set meaning. And what took place was beyond all words and description. It was the center of all creation. It was a purifying seriousness that cleansed the brain of every thought and feeling. Its seriousness was as lightning that destroys and burns up. The profundity of it was not measurable. It was there, immovable, impenetrable, a solidity that was as light as the heavens. It was in the eyes, in the breath. It was in the eyes, and the eyes could see. The eyes that saw, that looked, were wholly different from the eyes of the organ, and yet they were the same eyes. It was only seeing, the eyes that saw beyond time, space. There was impenetrable dignity and a peace that was the essence of all movement, action. No virtue touched it, for it was beyond all virtue and sanctions of man. It was there, imperishable, unmeasurable, the unknowing. No thought could ever penetrate it. No action could ever touch it. It was pure, untouched, and so ever dyingly beautiful.
Beautifully written.
But just words.
Beautiful words.
But takes you to the essence of that sacredness. No thought could touch it, because it wasn't from thought, it wasn't from thinking. And beyond time and space. So ego is of time and space. And functional thought is of time and space. And we need it. But other than that, what are we holding on to? What are we holding on to? What makes up the, as he says, the anxieties, the fears, the doubts, the hurts? What do we hold on to? And for what purpose? So it's really important to begin in our daily life to not only become, obviously, the meditation he's talking about, this awareness of every thought and feeling, the moment-by-moment meditation, but the meditation of beauty, and to put awareness, that which we are, onto that beauty. And you know how you light up, because you can substitute the word beauty for goodness, for innocence. So giving attention to those things. I think that must help with this arduous task of watching the mind. Do you think?
Mm-hmm.
What do you
think? Yeah, I wonder. Like, because it is such an arduous thing, and you can feel it, oh my God, another thought. Jesus. Oh, I've been away for 5 minutes. I thought, and it just feels like a slugfest, like a boxing match that you're losing. Eventually, you just want to put the pillow over your head and go to sleep. But like when you talked about the spaciousness, that like felt for me something like, wow, I would really like to have that.
Yes.
The crowding is the crowded monkey thoughts, and then the space.
That's right.
I guess it feels like anything that, like you just said, anything that can soften the arduous task of being present and aware has got to be a great boon.
I think, you know, when you say, oh, there's awareness, oh, of another thought, another feeling, another, I think in that moment it's important to see that that too is a thought, you know, and just go very easy and slowly, easy, very easy. It's just a seeing.
Yeah.
You know, like you step on a pebble and then, oh, it's a pebble. You know, just a seeing with no no comment. No,
yeah.
You know, just the seeing. But yes, it's essential for that spaciousness, which we fundamentally are, that there be more awareness of the flowering of goodness in our daily life. And do it through beauty. I think he's right. Because there's beauty all around.
You don't really notice the beauty unless you have that space.
That's
every
right.
Every simple thing that's beautiful.
That's right.
Because you notice it.
Exactly, exactly. So now we have to put attention.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's the hardest part, is just remembering not to forget. Because you know, we all just go on automatic.
That's true.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's such a, you know, our natural state of mind is so heavily just conditioned by the familiar.
Right.
Right? But it, you know, it's the remembering, moment by moment. And then when I stop remembering and I forget, just the coming back. But just to start off each day with a recognition, you know, that I want to be watchful, that I want to allow for the watching to be my default position rather than automatic. And you know, the term flowering of goodness is just such a beautiful, beautiful term. You know, how could you want anything better than that to remind you on how you want to start your day? You know, put that up somewhere on the mirror in the bathroom, right? And I was thinking, you know, can you imagine if the world leaders or somebody at the UN or all the political people got to say, well, here's my project I'm suggesting. Why don't we all get behind the flowering of goodness? Wow. And everybody really wants that. It's just that we're just nudged away from it, pushed away from it, mostly through conditioning and lack of attention.
Right. Our conditioning.
That's right. And ignorance. Really, no other way.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah, I just thought about, I'm bragging about all this light of awareness and all this stuff, and I forgot all about putting the lights on, as you probably noticed, so much for me and aware.
Well, you finally remembered.
It was a delayed reaction, I guess.
Thank you.
Any questions about what we just read?
Well, you know, that last bit of reading that you did that I thought was so beautiful. Krishnamurti, I've often felt, is one of the hardest people for me to read, because he seems very stern.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, compared to somebody like Satchitananda or somebody who smiles.
Yeah.
So I've always been kind of tentative about Krishnamurti.
Yes.
Yet that last passage was just like,
he's another voice, you know, and yes, he is. He can be very, very stern.
Yeah.
But what he's saying has so much truth in it. And beauty.
Mm.
Yeah. Actually, what I had read to you was from his notebook. He has a few books, three, I believe, Krishnamurti's notebook. And for a number of years, he just had it like a journal, a notebook of the sacred, of his touching the sacred. Which is, he doesn't really ever talk about it directly, because it's more important. He doesn't want you to create another concept.
Mm.
You know, he wants you to find this for yourself.
Mm.
So he's interested in what's in the way of finding it for yourself. So he wants you to clear out what isn't sacred, and then there is the sacred.
So what does he talk about at his talks, or did he talk about at his talks?
Oh, he spoke about every subject you could think of. Life, death, relationship. Actually, I strongly encourage going to YouTube, and he has so many, there are so many videos of his talks, and I strongly encourage you watching them.
We've played them here in the past.
In the past we used to.
Some people find it hard to stay with him, like to watch an hour of Krishnamurti, because he's very serious. He makes no effort to entertain.
No.
He doesn't.
Right?
No.
And he's just earnestly, with all seriousness, trying to help you see through your daily life and what's at stake for you, and to help you you know, see what's really going on. And some people like that style and some don't.
Right.
Yeah. But that's the flavor of his talks. And he talks about, you know, the suffering of humanity.
Yes.
That's what his main, you know, well,
yes.
look at the suffering and look at your suffering.
Yes.
And you
are
the world
different.
And the world is you.
You know, as you're speaking of all these things, I have this image of the movie Gandhi at the end, where 9,000 Indians come to stand up with no sign of fear. That they might all be massacred. Is that a place where there's no ego?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No self-preservation. What is it? Self-preservation?
Self-protection.
Protection and expansion or something.
And that part of it scares me a little bit. Does it mean that if I really consent to that way of being, am I making myself vulnerable in a way that's not safe?
Again, you know, that question is being asked by the ego. And I don't know if those thousands of people that came would if that meant ego-free, because, you know, the mind can take you to a cause larger than yourself. Look at people that commit suicide for a belief. I think what he's talking about here, when we're free of that me, I think there's more clarity, better discretion about what's right action and not, what's safe and not. Because there is no goal to achieve, because a belief is driving me. It's just clarity, it's just seeing, it's being in that spaciousness where you are not, everything is part of you and you are part of everything. There is no me, no separation. That's what it felt like when we used to go and hear him talk, especially in California in the Oak Grove. There were thousands of people, and it all felt like one.
So I guess he didn't need that charisma. I mean, just the...
It was just the words. It just...
Thousands of people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because it was, yeah, it was telling the truth.
Yeah. There's beauty in truth because truth is beauty.
Mm-hmm.
So when you hear it, that touches the truth and beauty in you. And so you're drawn to it.
What I always remember about the movie Gandhi, and it's relevant here to the flowering of goodness, is when the Hindus and the Muslims are rioting and killing one another. And Gandhi goes into this fast and he's at his death door. And this Hindu who has been murdering and pillaging Muslims, right, comes to him and says, please, please, God, I've done terrible things, I've murdered, I've often, you know, but don't die, don't come back, don't do this. And what can I do? He pleads him. And so Gandhi is weak and he says, go find the child that's been orphaned and raise him as your own. And he says, yes, I'll do it, I'll do it. The guy's about to leave. And he grabs it and he says, only make it a Muslim child.
I remember that vividly.
Right? That's the flowering of goodness.
Sometimes I ask myself a question, if I have, what should I do in this situation? And instead of what I want to do, I say, I'm going to do what needs to be done. And that kind of puts me into
mm-hmm.
This needs to be done without any judgment.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm.
He grew up in what was the name of that order? In natural,
the Theosophy.
Oh, yeah.
Madame Blavatsky and the Theosophists.
Yeah, I read his autobiography.
Yes, very
amazing.
Yes.
So interesting.
Yes.
Yeah.
Crazy life.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Was he a child when he was introduced
mm-hmm.
to the people in that movement?
Mm-hmm.
They adopted him.
They adopted him, right. How old, do you know?
10, I thought 10 years old.
It's 10.
It's my understanding.
The Madame Blavatsky and her sidekick, I forget his name.
Oh.
Yes. They were happened to be on this beach in Mumbai, I think, and she said that she believed in auras.
Her or one of
Him, the other guy, I think. Ledbetter.
Yes, but there was another woman.
Yeah.
I don't know that it was.
Yeah. And they believed in auras, and they said that they saw this child, Krishnamurti, and that he had the clearest aura of anyone that they had ever seen. And that's why they were galvanized toward him.
Hmm.
And they went to his parents and said, can we adopt him?
No, or educate him.
Educate him.
Mm-hmm.
Let us, we'll educate him, give him more life than you couldn't. And that's what happened.
And they took him back to London.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's where
he him and his brother.
Right, him and his brother.
Well, an example of that is when we see a diamond, right? A diamond shines.
Yeah.
It has an aura. Do we like a diamond? Would we go for it? Would we culture it and want to keep it? So that I think we can be diamonds.
Yes.
And some people can see that.
Yeah, there you go.
And he really struggled with his health a lot, right? I mean, he had crazy fevers and...
Yeah.
I'm sure they can remember that.
Yeah.
Was there any knowledge of the kind of life he had had up until 10 years old?
I don't know the answer to that. No.
Hmm.
I guess poor, I think.
He was poor.
Yeah, poor. Yes. Grew up in India, born in India. Yeah.
And was raised in great luxury.
Mom, yeah.
Once they adopted him, because they had all these wealthy people, and the Order of the Star was full of all these, a good many of them anyway, were wealthy people. And that was the circle he traveled in. And he went over giving talks and all that.
Right.
There's a Krishnamurti Foundation in America. I think this is in India as well, because we went there.
Yeah.
And you could look that up online, and they have meetings, and they have a lot of his videos as well, and I think podcasts and books. And in Ojai, there's a house where he used to stay, and it's quite lovely. You can go there and spend a weekend there or a week there and just meditate and read and... It's very beautiful, very beautiful.
We did that, we went and stayed.
Yes,
yeah. Yeah, recently, about four.
A few years ago,
yeah.
Do you actually stay at the house or
you can
stay? Could stay at the house. It's become like a B&B now.
Wow.
Yes. The beautiful library in a beautiful setting.
Is it true that he geared the geographical places of his speeches to make people take some kind of journey to arrive at them as a way of experiencing? Because I had a friend that said she climbed miles up the Alps.
Well, he would give talks in New York City, in Carnegie Hall, in Ojai, California, and in Gestad.
And in England.
In Brockwood Park. Those were the main places that
and
he
in
spoke.
India.
And in Madras, in India.
I think two or three places in India.
What, is Gestalt in Switzerland?
Yes.
That's where she went.
Yes.
And there were public talks. You gave a donation if you so desired.
Or not. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we heard him speak in several places, but the most beautiful was in Ojai, California, as Evelyn said.
Mm-hmm.
Ojai is a beautiful place. And California's in. This is in a valley where they grow a lot of oranges and the smell of the blossoms.
Wow. Oh, yeah.
And we were sitting in the Krishnamurti School and Center in Ojai, California. There's an oak grove of 100-year-old oak trees.
Mm-hmm.
And, it was just undulating little hills. And that's where we all sat, about 2,000 people sat there. Bluebirds flying around, a beautiful day, and you waited, and then, he would arrive, you'd hear a car door pull up and close, and they had just a chair, just like that, on a little platform, and he would sit. He always wore the same thing, like gray slacks and just a plain shirt, and It was like I felt like I was at the Sermon on the Mount. Mm. That's how beautiful it was, and tranquil and infused with that energy. It was really quite an experience.
But he used to say, don't be a follower.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that must be real.
Yeah, don't be a follower.
He saw a lot of that.
Right, he would always say.
So I encourage you to look up some of the videos. You'll see somewhere in Oak Grove.
I don't see you guys.
I don't know.
Very interesting.
Yeah, actually, I remember when I was watching it on YouTube, and there were these long silences sometimes.
Yeah. And actually, that was off. That was our entry into the whole spiritual domain.
Really?
Yeah.
Well,
wow, what a
because
the deep end.
Well, it was so interesting because my son was in high school and he
taking an alternative class, you know. Alternative class.
English, I think in English, or literature, I don't even remember, and he brought home the book called Freedom from the Known.
Wow.
Because they were reading it.
Yeah.
And he said, you guys might be interested in this book.
Gosh. How old was he?
And he was in high school, I don't remember, 14, 15. And we read the book, and then the next week we're on a plane to California.
Wow. That's amazing.
Yeah. That's right. Sometimes the call is not from despair. I think most often it is. But sometimes the call is from a place of wonderful love and almost bliss, and there's a call to this.
Yeah.
And then it happens, it just happens like a book was handed to us. My son handed this book to us. But I don't think that's an accident. I think that's how it was meant to unfold.
I think the despair is exactly a dialogue to that call of love. I think it's that call of love that makes puts us in the despair, because even though we can't put it into words, we know that we're not present in some way.
That's right.
It's kind of intermingled, or maybe intermingled. For me, I think it was intermingled with the sense that of getting in touch with the fact that I'm more than what I am. Even though there was despair too, it was like realizing that you're more than that, you know.
That's right.
So in that respect, it's a blessing to have all of those.
Correct.
Be whatever disadvantages or, you know.
Yeah. Interesting, because in A Course in Miracles book, he says that everything in life is either love or a call for love, so that's what you were saying.
Mm-hmm.